good. If I had your attention, please. Thank you very much. My name is Mark Lopez. I'd like to thank you for coming out and participating in Congressman Pete Visclosky's East Chicago Town Forum. Before we begin, I'd like to ask people or remind people if you have any electronic devices, if you could please place those to vibrate or silent to prevent any distractions during the course of the forum. To set the stage, Congressman Pete Visclosky will discuss issues affecting our nation as well as Northwest Indiana. Concluding his remarks, we'll answer questions, starting first with those on the index cards that were offered to you as you entered the room. Upon completing the question on the index card, we'll take questions from the audience. If you had a friend or family member who was unable to participate or they wanted to attend but due to personal or professional obligations they could not, I would ask that you direct them to Congressman Pete Visclosky's website. Early next week, we'll have a recorded town forum online that can be viewed. There'll be a link attached to that presentation that will allow them to submit any questions that they may have after watching the Congressman's remarks. We tried that last year for the first time and people seemed to like it, so we're going to continue the second year. At this time, I'd like to acknowledge elected official who's joined with us here this afternoon. Please join me in welcoming Mayor Anthony Copeland. But I also have the privilege and pleasure of introducing a very talented student from the St. Stanislaus school system who will do the formal introduction of the congressman as well as the beginning for a public forum here in the city of East Chicago. Please join me in welcoming Erica Campos.
My name is Erica Campos and I'm at the 8th grade at St. Stanislaus School. Please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. You may be seated. The first congressional district encompasses all of Lake, Porter, and the western portions of LaPorte County, including Michigan City and Westville. The district is home to cities, towns, and rural areas alike with a total population of 712,000. It is represented by Congressman Pete Visclosky, a lifelong resident of Northwest Indiana. Our district's origins are rooted in the Industrial Revolution. Steel mills and oil refineries located along the Lake Michigan shoreline. We have grown over the years and are now home to many institutions of higher learning, such as Purdue University Calumet, Purdue University North Central, Calumet College of St. Joseph, Ivy Tech, as well as Congressman Visclosky's alma mater, Indiana University Northwest. We are proud to have the Indiana Dunes National Lakeshore and its great natural beauty that covers 15,000 acres and attracts 3 million visitors annually. Our district is home to ArcelorMittal, U.S. Steel, BP, and many other significant employers that drive our local economy and support our communities. Our region has been referred to as the crossroads of America, as four interstates and every major railroad east of the Mississippi River converge here. These factors, combined with our greatest resource, the hardworking men and women of Northwest Indiana, make our region an important part of our country's economy today. In closing, throughout Congressman Pete Visclosky's career, he has worked with local, state, and federal officials, as well as community leaders, to ensure the first congressional district continues to strengthen our industrial base and enhance economic opportunities for our next generation. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Pete Visclosky.
Thank you very much. Don't go anyplace. Yeah, I think you'd all agree Erica did a great job for us. A number of you have been at our past forums, and you know that the students are selected because of their academic achievement. Obviously, she's certainly an example of that, is on the academic bowl team, also loves to read, and also is athletic on St. Sam's basketball team. Earlier today, her team won. I don't want to tell you the score. It was not close. But unlike some of our other students who got out of a little school for helping us out, she gave up her time this afternoon, as all of you have, and want to give her a certificate of appreciation. Thank you so much. I want to thank all of you for coming out. We have our mayor here, and it is a Saturday afternoon, although I must say that it is a balmy January afternoon in Northwest Indiana to discuss the issues of the day. It is a new year, and a new year certainly connotes change, and the change most pertinent to our discussion is the fact that a new congressman was sworn in this past week, the 113th Congress. In the past, as you know, I have served on the Appropriations Committee in the House of Representatives. That committee is charged with making decisions about domestic and defense discretionary spending. I will continue to serve on that committee in the next Congress. In the past, I've also served on the Energy and Water Subcommittee, as well as the Defense Subcommittee, and will also continue to do that. What will change is my responsibilities on the subcommittee. In the past, I have served as the chairman or ranking Democrat on the Energy and Water Subcommittee. That committee has about $30 billion worth of jurisdiction over federal spending for water projects throughout the United States. You think about the Indian Harbor Ship Canal, our nuclear weapons programs, as well as the Department of Energy. That will change in this Congress. I will now serve as the ranking Democrat on the Defense Appropriations Subcommittee. That subcommittee has jurisdiction over about $609 billion worth of spending, obviously directed towards the Department of Defense. I certainly would want all of you to know that I'm very serious about my responsibilities to continue to ensure the security of our nation, to make sure that those who serve us in military uniform are as safe as possible in the performance of their duties, and to do so in as cost-effective a fashion as possible. As we proceed with this form, whether as a member of Congress or as a citizen, I certainly think it's right that we also remember that we continue to be a nation at war. Despite the withdrawal of our troops from the country of Iraq, we continue to have a significant military presence in the country of Afghanistan. And to date, 2,512 Americans have lost their lives in combat in that country. Some of those individuals have been from Northwest Indiana. Many others have come back with very serious injuries, and all of their families have a significant burden. Going forward, we certainly ought to keep all of them and their families in our thoughts and prayers. The President has indicated that we have a number of goals as far as our military presence in Afghanistan. One is to retard the capabilities of the insurgency in that country, as well as to work to strengthen the government of that country, as well as to help build its economy. Those goals certainly cannot be met absent the desire of the Afghan people themselves. The President has also indicated that he believes that we will have to have troops in that country through at least at the end of this coming year, 2014. And the commander in the field has indicated he believes that we will have to have military forces in that country beyond that date. Despite the fact that about 24,000 less troops are on the ground in Afghanistan today than when we last met at a forum in East Chicago at City Hall, I do think the time has come and gone for all of our troops to be withdrawn from that country. Turning to the economy, I would note that in January 2009, 4 years ago, we had 839,000 Americans lose their job in 1 month. In that same month, we had 13 million Americans with no work at all. It was the month that President Obama was sworn into office. This past month, December of 2012, 11.3 million Americans were without work. We have made some grudging progress, but I think to everyone in this room, it's still an unacceptable figure. And it certainly is when you consider that this past month, we have 2,948 individuals in Lake County, LaPorte County, and Porter County file for unemployment compensation. It's certainly why I and many others will continue to work as hard as possible to keep the good-paying jobs we have in Northwest Indiana and to invest in our economic infrastructure to create new good-paying jobs in the future. Certainly think the first point of departure as far as keeping what we have is to attack our trade deficit and certainly protect ourselves against illegal trading practices internationally. The Economic Policy Institute indicates they believe our nation has lost about 2.7 million jobs since 2001 because of illegal trade practices internationally. It's certainly one reason why this past Wednesday morning I testified before the International Trade Commission in Washington on a corrosion-resistant flat product that is produced right here in Northwest Indiana. And it's certainly why in the last Congress I testified on five other occasions before the International Trade Commission on other steel cases as well as other manufacturing cases to try to protect those jobs. During the last Congress, the 112th Congress, three trade agreements were agreed to. The countries of Colombia, Panama, and South Korea. I must tell you, I voted against all three of those trade agreements because I believe they place American workers at a competitive disadvantage. And must tell you that I remain very upset that the Congress and the administration have not yet adequately addressed the issue of the Chinese government's manipulation of the value of their currency, driving it down to unrealistic levels that again disadvantage everyone who works for a living in the United States. In last Congress, I co-sponsored legislation to try to deal with this issue. I unfortunately did not see this legislation enacted into law. We'll co-sponsor similar legislation in the 113th Congress, and we'll work hard for it. But I also think if a company outsources jobs, they ought not to be rewarded with our tax monies and should not be eligible for federal grants, loans, and subsidies if they ship their employment overseas. Well, I introduced legislation in the last two Congresses to address this issue and to prohibit that from happening. I'll regret that the Congress has not seen fit to adopt that legislation, but we'll reintroduce it in this Congress and continue to push for its passage. But also, we do need to make an investment in our infrastructure. We have had in the state of Indiana, and I mentioned it at last year's forum, 4,091 bridges that were declared deficient or obsolete. We do not have new complete figures as to what that total is in our state today as we meet, but a year has passed and several things have changed. One's very positive and one is not so positive. We all are very, very familiar with Indianapolis Boulevard and the bridge over the Gibson Rail Yard. A four-lane bridge, but you can only use two lanes. The decision has been reached within the last month to expend $17 million of our taxes to rebuild that bridge. And I do think that's a wise investment of our monies, not only as far as the movement of people throughout Northwest Indiana, but to assist the city of Hammond in further developing job creation at the Gibson Rail Yard. Second bridge is in East Chicago, and everyone in this room is very familiar with that. The media had a picture of the final demolition of the bridge over Klein Avenue. Certainly the mayor and the members of the council have worked very hard to, if you would, repair the injury done to the city as well as the basic industry in this region of Lake County to see a reconstruction take place. We need to make that type of reinvestment. Well, I tell people we have an unparalleled network of economic infrastructure, particularly as far as transportation in our region. Whether it is highways, whether it's rail, whether it's water or aviation assets, we need to invest further. But I would suggest to you that we have made some progress since we last met. In the area of highways, after 9 temporary extents, the Congress has approved a new highway reauthorization bill for 27 months. As we proceed with the 113th Congress, we'll work very hard for a full 5-year extension of that program. We also have a significant rail network in Northwest Indiana. As I like to describe it, every rail line east of the Mississippi goes through Lake and Porter and LaPorte County, trying to get around the Great Lakes. Often, in cities like East Chicago, it's an inconvenience, but it's also a great economic resource. And after some years of negotiations, the state and the federal government have come to an agreement to invest about $71.3 million to improve the at-grade freight crossings in 8 locations across Northwest Indiana, essentially from Porter, Indiana to the Illinois state line, to help move freight more efficiently through our area and to improve our ability to handle it and create jobs doing so. I was very happy to work with Governor Daniels and the state to ensure that that agreement took place. But we have international water facilities in Northwest Indiana. We have a very important waterway in the city of East Chicago, the Indiana Harbor Ship Canal. Fully dredged, it should be at 27 feet so that ships can come in fully laden and leave fully laden so that they're efficient. We can put people to work, and the steel industry and oil refineries in our areas can be as efficient as they can be. Today, as I think most of you appreciate it, it's not at depth, it's at 20 feet. But for the first time since 1972, that harbor is now being dredged. And it has not, over the course of years, been without controversy. But I do think it has been that citizen participation in East Chicago that has made it a much better and much safer process. And again, for your city officials and for the mayor, really applaud them for their hard work and cooperation to see that this economic investment is made. And another benefit that is also very important is to have an environmental improvement of that waterway with the removal of 7 feet of contaminated sediment. The question about the development of the Gary Airport may have been raised at last year's forum. We would have had a discussion about that. On Monday morning, you can drive past the airport and see someone actually expanding the airport. Again, I believe a wise investment of our dollars, because longer term, whether it is charter, whether it is freight, general aviation, or commercial, I am convinced it is going to lead to significant job growth and job diversification in our region. These investments should not be just for more jobs that we already have, although that would be fine with me. But we ought to look for diversification as well, which is why I am happy to have worked with Ivy Tech to help develop a logistics and distribution course of studies at their Gary campus so students can begin to prepare themselves for these types of jobs. And why I'm also happy to have worked with Purdue University Calumet. They now have an energy center. They have a water institute. They have a computational and visualization research center doing very sophisticated work to help in the education of individuals in Northwest Indiana and those who now come to Lake County for an education, as well as to help, again, our basic manufacturing with critical research, particularly as far as how to conserve more energy with the production of steel. But in conclusion, as we proceed with the 113th Congress and this new year, I would certainly assure you that I will continue to do my best to ensure with my new responsibilities that we have a secure nation. But would also make the observation that I don't believe the cooperation among our local officials and our state officials has ever been better than it is today. And I also would say that of the cooperation between our labor leaders and business community, not that things are perfect every day, as well as those who are engaged in the not-for-profit sector to try to help improve our community. And so certainly as we proceed, also want to continue to partner with them, including those in East Chicago, to keep what we have, to make an investment, and to hopefully create some new jobs in the future. But with that, I have a couple of cards, and I'll take those. If the going gets tough, I'm going to ask Erica to answer the questions, and then we'll open it up from the floor.
You can use the mic if you want.
First, there's a couple of questions relative to firearms, and I'll read both of them and then have some remarks. The first is, did you vote in favor of legislation making schools and other so-called gun-free zones, I call them victim disarmament zones? If so, and you voted yes, do you feel guilty and remorse for all of the innocent women and children who were murdered recently? It could have been defended by people being able to protect themselves against people who caused this horrific event. Additionally, as far as guns and schools, currently there is a law about no firearms within 1,000 feet of school. Legislation has been introduced in the U.S. Congress to repeal that. Given some of the tragic events that have occurred, there will be legislation considered in this Congress relative to firearms. It is impossible to predict today as we meet here what form that will take, both in the House as well as in the Senate. But would make a couple of comments, because during my tenure in Congress, so we have had two significant votes dealing with firearms, and would like to provide you with information as to how I voted so you have a perspective on where I am coming from. The first of these votes was the Brady bill that essentially called for background checks of those who purchase weapons so that police officials and law enforcement officials could do a background check. That has evolved into an automated system. It is mandatory in the state of Indiana. It was strongly supported by local law enforcement officials. I voted for the Brady bill. The second bill during the Clinton administration was to prohibit the sale, manufacture, and distribution of semi-automatic weapons and to limit the amount of cartridges in a magazine to 10. I voted for that legislation, and it was in effect for a 10-year period of time. It lapsed because it was not reauthorized during George Bush's presidency. I would also point out that because people raise legitimately concerns to ensure that the Constitution is not violated, in this case, the Second Amendment. And as I pointed out to other audiences, during that 10-year period of time, no one challenged the constitutionality of either one of those laws before the Supreme Court. People have asked, as was on both of these cards, about the issue of guns in school and arming guards, if you would. Ultimately, those types of decisions rest with local school authorities and school boards. But I've also indicated that we have come to a point in our society where we have to arm people in elementary schools and have people walking around in schools with guns. We have other problems we need to address. The next question is on the DREAM Act, and the question is, how did you vote? 2 years ago, at the end of the 111th Congress, there was a vote in the House on legislation to essentially provide for a path of her citizenship for young people who are in the United States in an undocumented fashion because they were brought here by their parents. They were innocent of that decision to come to the United States. I voted no on that legislation. There is no question we have a problem as far as immigration policy in the United States. There is no question that these young people came to our country innocently. But the fact is, I do think there is still a distinction between those who are undocumented and those who are here legally in our country. In our office, we, every day of the work week, help people who are in the United States legally, who are pursuing naturalization, and helping them along with the process. In the end, this legislation, because immigration will, again, I think, be actively debated in the 113th Congress, be brought up. Again, it's speculative as to what form it will take, but because it's a continuing legislative issue, I would encourage all of you, regardless of what your position is on the issue, to continue to stay in touch with me and my office. My question is, some people must pay federal income taxes on Social Security benefits. This happens if you have other substantial income. No one pays taxes on more than 85% of their Social Security benefits. And the second question, also relating to Social Security, is why do we have to pay taxes on Social Security if we are still working? The answer essentially is, depending upon what your level of income is, and as the person rightfully points out, there is a cap of 85% relative to that portion attributable to Social Security, you may be liable to pay some federal tax. Those provisions, one, originally before I went to Congress, secondly, the increase to that limit to provide more tax payments from Social Security was voted on while I was in Congress, and I voted for it. Was to ensure that we continue to have an adequate stream of monies going into Social Security. And I would emphasize, for the taxes paid on that portion for Social Security checks and income, it is returned to the Social Security Trust Fund, not to the General Treasury. Because originally, as well as when I was confronted with the decision to make, we had to act to ensure the solvency of Social Security going forward. And one of the ways of doing this is to emphasize that those who were making a certain income level, I believe it's approximately $40,000, do pay some tax, but again, to have that tax put back into Social Security. It has worked in that Social Security is now solvent until 2033. That's the good news. The bad news is it's solvent until 2033. And for some people in this room, that might be okay. But for Erica and that next generation, it certainly isn't. And I think everybody in this room grew up in a household where the rule was you leave the world a little bit better, and you make sure you're thinking about that next generation coming up. Which is why I tell my colleagues, Social Security, and I'd include Medicare in this, is not part of the deficit problem. But I do think we ought to examine the programs and look for actions we can take to make them solvent further into the future to ensure their existence for the people in this room as well as the next generation. I saw an article that Social Security simply has IOUs in it and they have no value. Have another card also on Social Security and Medicare with the issue of IOUs being in Social Security. Let me address that as well. There is a debate going on in Washington today about balancing the budget. 2 weeks ago, we had a very emotional vote. If you remember the controversies that pertain, I voted no. And I was one of only 16 Democrats to vote no. Because my point of departure is we should talk about, we should act upon Social Security and Medicare to make them fundamentally sounder than they are today. But not to use them as a piggy bank to balance the budget. If we ignore those programs too long, they will become part of the budget problem. With the vote that took place 2 weeks ago, the problem becomes where some of my colleagues, I think of Senator McConnell, who says he doesn't ever want to talk about taxes again, but he wants to look at spending. When two-thirds of every dollar we spend is interest on the debt, Social Security and Medicare. That's not where you start. The question about the IOUs and that Congress and presidents of both parties have simply taken money out of Social Security, though, I have to tell you, even though you may have seen it on the internet, it is not true. It is not true. And someone in this room may go home tonight and get back on the internet and say, Pete lied, because it's on the internet. It's not true. Years before I came to the Congress, in the late 70s and early 80s, when I think Congress was much more functional than it is today, and people anticipated the future, they took important actions to begin to build up a trust fund. Because as I remind everyone, on Monday morning, 10,000 people in the United States of America are going to sign up for Social Security. And on Tuesday, 10,000 people are going to sign up for Social Security. And on Wednesday, 10,000 people are going to sign up for Social Security for years to come. It's called the baby boom. They could see it coming and acted responsibly and said, we are going to establish and build up a trust fund so that the money is there for that baby boom generation. The good news is there is more money in Social Security today than there was on Friday. There will be more money in Social Security on Sunday than there is today. For several reasons, the most important of which, there is now interest being earned by Social Security on the trust fund. Because if I'm accumulating a surplus and I'm accumulating cash, you do one of two things with it. You take it and you store it all here at post 369. You know it's going to be safe. And then you take it out when you need it, but you don't earn any interest. Or do you invest it to earn interest and put that money in Social Security so it's even sounder? They made the right decision, and this again was before I went to Congress. Let's invest it. And they bought the safest investment on the planet Earth, U.S. government bonds. Essentially, Social Security loans it to the government, they get a bond. The government has spent that money on other pursuits. But interest is being paid every day on those bonds, and those bonds will be redeemed. Many people, and at least two in this audience, are looking at me like, you're nuts. They're never going to pay the bonds back. I asked you, in 225 years, has the U.S. government once defaulted on a $25 savings bond or a $10,000 bill? Never. Never. We will pay those bonds back. The important thing is to get our fiscal house in order so that process is not dislocated to the general taxpayer to come up with that money to buy those bonds back. And I'd make a further point that interest is important. Before 2008, I could tell you there's going to be more money in Social Security tomorrow than today, and that's true, because there was more payroll tax coming in than benefits going out. We had a collapse in the economy. We have 11.3 million people not working. There's more people signing up for Social Security every day. The differential now is being made up by the income generated and being paid by the federal government into the fund. That will continue to happen until 2023. After that, we will have to start buying the bonds back again, all the more reason to balance the budget. But please understand, no one has ever taken money out of that system. With that, I am out of cards, and I would be happy to entertain some questions from the floor. Yes, sir.
I've heard it more than once that the United States government owes Social Security $2.3 trillion. And furthermore, talk about in 1935 when Roosevelt signed the Social Security bill, he said it was between the employer and employee. He said nothing about alcoholics, dope addicts, or kids that didn't want to learn or couldn't learn, they get a check every month. Who put that in? Politicians who want to get reelected. So they're going to give something, but they took it from the working people. You want to give them something, take it out of the general fund. Tax the rich people if you want, tax them more. Why take it out of the working people? And that's what they did, they took it out of the working people. I cashed my daughter's check, not cashed, but I picked it up the other day because she's on vacation, she's a teacher. Paid $191 for Social Security for 2 weeks. The next payday she's going to pay $234 for Social Security. I remember when, Greenwater, well, he ran for president against Johnson. He said, you will pay more Social Security one day than you do federal tax. I see it coming. There's something wrong, real bad. And Medicare, that's another story. Every day you put on television, I hear it, it aggravates me, especially Arthur. Medicare only pays 80%. We pay the other 20. That the other 20 pays cost you $200, $240. For that 80%, I pay $106. It boggles my mind. Why don't we take that $240 and put it in Medicare and our problems are over? Plus, there's a lot of mistakes in Medicare. And I can tell you one that doesn't bug everybody, but I took care of my wife 24/7 for 11 years, and she was on dialysis. So they said, we'll give you a portable machine at home, but you're too old. You're too old to learn. I flew planes, I run cranes, bulldozers, anything that'll move, I'll operate. No, you're too old. Well, ambulance, $450 to dialysis, $450 back, and my $800-$900 to dialysis. The girl that runs the machine, she could do it. She goes to the hospital, she gets $100, but she's not allowed to come to my house. I call Social Security and ask you, that woman says, look, I just follow the rules. Who makes these rules? This girl will do it for $100, and I gotta get an ambulance $450 each way, plus pay the dialysis $800-$900. Of course, Medicare's paying it, but that's ours.
That's why they do that.
How do you do that? Yeah, that's, you're not running this.
That's why they make it complicated, so there's more hands
on the plan. It just boggles my mind. I said, we pay 20%, yeah, for $240, and Medicare's paying 80% for $106. It doesn't make sense to me. So we got trouble with Medicare. No, we got trouble with the supplement. Take that supplement and put it in Medicare. I think the president mentioned once that he wanted a one payer. But everybody else over there just thumbs down. And my good friend Bai, Senator Bai, I had a lot of faith in him. Then when I found out his wife was on 3 insurance companies for $1.5 million a year, I know how he voted. You know, what are you gonna do? Guys over at the bar told me, you ain't gonna get nothing done. That's about right. You know, you can holler and squeak. In England, they let you go to the park and you can get out of stuff and holler all you want. You know, nothing's gonna be done anyway.
Yeah, they have rules at 369. You can only push it so far. Sir, I appreciate your concern, and you're correct. The federal government owes a lot of money to Social Security. But I'm deadly serious when I tell you they're going to pay it back. This idea that suddenly after 225 years, and particularly as far as seniors in America, the federal government's going to just not pay bonds back, that they're just worthless. We're the wealthiest country in the world. We have the best government in the world, despite some who say the government's never done anything for me. Those bonds will be paid back. Social Security doesn't go to people who are alcoholics. I regret that some people who receive checks probably suffer from alcoholism. And the fact is, some people have very serious disabilities and they do receive Social Security disability. If there have been mistakes made in the past, and I would point out one, and it wasn't a mistake, it was well-intentioned, and it was changed. is the effort, and again, long before I got to Congress, people wanted to help seniors. And Congress and the president passed a law that said if you're a senior and you have a child and they start college, we will send your child a check to help with their education. My youngest sister started college and she started getting a check from Social Security, absolutely the law of the land, because my father had turned 65. And then one of the changes, again, before I went to Congress, they said, well, listen, we should have educational loans program. You think of the Stafford loans, you think of Pell Grant for educational purposes. We ought to hang on all this money for the intended purposes, is that is the pension you have paid for and you have earned. So they eliminated that program. So I would emphasize to you going forward, there's also ways we can change it to solidify without touching the benefits. I tell people I have an open mind. But one of the things we ought to be looking at is equity. And I would agree with you as far as, hey, who's paying the load here? For people who earn more than $113,700 a year, they stop paying Social Security tax. You're absolutely right on another point. The average person I represent in the 1st Congressional District pays more in payroll tax than they do in income tax. That's their pension and that's their health care for their retirement. But you stop paying at $113,000. My proposal would be don't raise the tax rate. Do not raise the tax on employers, but take the cap off. If through good fortune you're making $400,000 a year, pay the tax. The overwhelming number of people I represent have always paid their Social Security tax until December 31st. They may wait on tables at the Legion. They may work in the mill. They may work in City Hall. But they pay it all year. If it's good enough for a waitress, if it's good enough for a steel worker, it's good enough for everybody. And that's how I would approach it. And then you don't change any benefits. On Medicare, I would also agree with your observation. We've got to make some significant changes. Medicare is suffering financially, and again, not because somebody take money out, but the demographics. 10,000 people a day are signing up for Medicare. My father, some of you knew Dad. He's still alive. He's 97. People didn't live that long before. His medical costs are more today than they were 20 years ago because he's 97 years old. It's going to cost more money. All the more reason to examine every one of these programs and you touch on one. Well, you got to get in an ambulance and go and come back and it costs you more money. I had that happen to my own family. My mother passed this past March, but she was in assisted living at St. Anthony getting terrific care. From time to time, something would happen. To go to St. Anthony's Hospital, which was in the same building, you had to call an ambulance. And I mean, I saw the bill. And I'm thinking, this is nuts, to use a technical term. So I have talked to my colleagues and said, listen, I can find you money here without taking benefits away from anybody who is a patient or a provider. If you need an ambulance, you call an ambulance. Mom could have been wheeled through the corridor to St. Anthony's Hospital. That's a savings without changing benefits. Another savings would be we should allow the government, on behalf of all of us as taxpayers, to negotiate with insurance companies on that Part D program, and seniors need help with prescription drugs. But I voted no. One of the reasons why the pharmaceutical companies can charge anything they want. We are prohibited as a government from negotiating price with some of these drug companies you rightfully reference. I tell people the drug companies got it both ways now. They have a huge new client base, Medicare, financed by our tax dollars, and the government's prohibited from talking about what they can charge. I voted no, because we should be able to negotiate that price, which doesn't mean it's going to be rock bottom, but give me a fighting chance. You bring up some very important points.
I could get it from England or Canada for half price, unless.
No, and that came up in the Hope Reform. I just touched on this and recognized the woman. For most of my tenure in Congress, I was opposed to the importation of drugs, whether individually or wholesale, for safety purposes. I wanted to make sure these drugs were tested, safe, what have you. I've seen so many abuses, particularly in steel industry, on what happens in some of these other countries. We're having a debate some years ago in the Appropriations Committee, in which I serve. Of course, someone who is very tied to the pharmaceutical companies, they have huge interests in his district, wanted to have a continued limitation on imports of drugs from, I want to buy them from Canada because they're cheaper. Can't do that. One of my other colleagues got up, who is a pharmacist by training, says, isn't it true 40% of all the drugs sold in the United States are imported anyway because of the compounds? Couldn't deny that. And and that's why you learn every day. I say, whoa, wait a minute. Yeah, oh, let's introduce some competition into this system. Yes, ma'am.
Speaking of the medical industry, I want to talk about Obamacare, mm-hmm. and specifically being forced, certain religious denominations, Catholic hospitals. Right now there's a case with Hobby Lobby that's being fined $1 million a day for their conscience and refusing to provide abortion-inducing drugs. According to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 18, we have the right to conscience. And everyone in a post-World War II era has that right to not be forced by the government to violate their own conscience. Is there something that would change Obamacare to allow businesses to choose that, when we're looking at businesses cutting employee rates because they have to provide services that they don't care to provide? It sounds to me a lot like tyranny, when you're being forced to accept a government program when the program you have is working fine. Additionally, when we also provide, we have hospitals that provide care for uninsured people, why are we as taxpayers being forced to pay additional money when there are already resources available for those people who do not have insurance?
Two answers to your question, and I would divide the question into two parts, the issue of abortion and the issue of contraceptives. I want to make it very clear that there are no federal monies spent on abortions in this country.
But they're spent on abortions in other countries. If you read Obamacare, the budget is for abortions.
No, ma'am. There are no federal funds available for abortions.
So
period.
Family planning in India and China.
Wait a minute. Let me address this issue.
It's not abortion.
That issue on family planning, and let me stick to abortions, has been litigated in federal court and has been constitutionally challenged because the state of Indiana, during its last term, prohibited Planned Parenthood from receiving any monies to provide health care. Now, the fact is, Planned Parenthood and anyone else who receives federal funds is prohibited from using those federal funds for abortions. And that issue was litigated in federal court, and the court said Indiana was wrong in prohibiting Planned Parenthood for the medical treatments and advice and counseling they provide, non-abortion related, for doing so. And I would suggest to you, and I will give you a family example. My sister, who is much younger than I, went to college. She received all of her health care, not abortion, health care. Preventive health care, annual testing for health care at where? Planned Parenthood, because she was in college, she was short money, and they provided her assistance. The idea that Planned Parenthood simply provides abortion and the federal government pays for it is not true. Okay. Secondly, under the health care bill, states, including Indiana, can pass legislation prohibiting insurers for providing for abortions, and I'm specific on abortions. Indiana passed that law last year. Indiana passed that law. So from my perspective, that is absolutely dealt with. The second issue is contraceptive services. Contraceptive services as preventive care are to be provided under the new health care bill. There are institutions, including one of my alma maters, Notre Dame, who has gone to federal court because of the religious connotation you allude to. I would point out, I think my alma mater is wrong and that we have dealt with that issue. There is an executive order indicating that religious denominations do not have to include contraceptive coverage in policies for their employees. Having said that, under the federal law, the insurance company still has to give those employees access to that in a separate negotiation if they want it, because maybe everybody out of those thousands and thousands of people that work at Notre Dame may want contraceptive coverage. And we will not pay for it as taxpayers. Notre Dame will not pay for it. That will be absorbed as a cost by the insurance company. Now, the response is, well, nothing's free. Listen, one of the things we did in that bill was to require that insurance companies start providing for our health care instead of their profit, and mandated that, depending on their size, 80 to 85% of what they get from us in premiums are paid for our health care. And additionally, the idea of preventive contraceptive services, it has something to do with abortion or religious belief, I would suggest to you was not in any way, shape, or form your motivation. The fact is, women of childbearing age in this country spend 68% more out-of-pocket expenses on their health care than men do. The point of the bill is to have some equality between men and women as far as providing health care.
Yes, in your introduction speech, you mentioned the Chinese manipulation of their currency, that it was low. And I was wondering if, maybe instead of paying attention to what other countries do with their currency, if you could pay attention to what, like, is going on in America today. We have a private banking cartel with the Federal Reserve, which they're actually not part of our government. They're private. And, you know, they've devalued our dollar 97% since their inception in 1913. And I was wondering how you respond to that, maybe pay more attention to that as opposed to like what the Chinese are doing with their currency.
Mm-hmm. I would respond in several instances. So one, first of all, the Federal Reserve is in fact a creature of the government of the United States because it was created by federal legislation.
A creature?
You're entitled to your opinion. I will continue with my answer. Secondly, I would point out that everyone who is engaged in federal activity should be audited and have supported legislation to audit the Federal Reserve. Other questions?
Which bill was that? The auditing?
It was introduced in the last Congress. You're free to contact our office. We'd be happy to give you the number. Yes, sir.
112th Congress.
I actually have a couple of questions, but if you don't have time for them, I'll email
my
you.
My time is your time.
Number one, you made reference to the Brady bill and the other bills that basically emphasize background checks and that type of thing. However, there's a lot of evidence-based research out there that roughly 30 to 40% of all guns that are sold legally do not have background checks. How do you propose making that bill so that it is equally and equitably enforced across the board so that all guns being sold would require a background check of some type, including the psychological aspects? Mm-hmm. Because right now, all we have, the primary thing against it in the background check is whether or not a person has any type of criminal background. There is no real piece of that that includes any type of psychological evaluation, if they've been involuntarily admitted. Now, if I admit myself, that's of course of a different color. However, if they're involuntarily admitted, then that. So how do you suggest we increase it from 60 to 70% having background checks to 100%?
One of the exemptions to background checks are gun shows, and it's a huge glaring exemption. I assume a part of the debate will be if we are going to, and we have now had for nearly two decades background checks for most gun purchases, that, as you point out, it should be for all gun purchases. Whether that will be brought to a specific vote on the House floor yet is speculation, but certainly think if it is fair for the overwhelming number of individuals who do legitimately buy firearms, it should be good enough for everybody. Right. On the mental health aspect, and you bring up a very important point, is unfortunately in the United States, we have tended historically, one, right off the bat, not to have parity as far as mental health coverage and services in this country. One of the things that the Congress did several years ago, and I voted for it, is to mandate parity between, if you would, physical health as well as mental health. That parity was further confirmed in the health care bill that we passed several years ago. The effort has to be, and you raise a valid point, is to make sure not only do you have parity in law, but in fact. Because as far as the provision of financial resources, and I think as importantly, the stigma of mental health, we as a government, as well as individual citizens, have to deal with that. There is a stigma, and many people feel a shame if they feel they have a particular problem. I had a loved one in my family, and I've used her as an example in other forums, who has some significant problems, and I begged her to get I'll go with you. There's no shame here. And she was so ashamed she had a problem, which was not of her making, she never went. So I would hope also, as we go forward, we're all understanding, we all do our part whenever the issue comes up, and if nothing else, to let people know, listen, this is a health issue. Because if some people had not felt a stigma, some people had gotten care, we might not have some problem. That is part of the problem. Sure.
I think especially when you consider that we used to have mental health hospitals, those were closed down. Then we have resident facilities, and a lot of times those are closed down. And mentally health, because of the stigma and because of the fact that we no longer really support the care of those, a lot of times they basically drop through the cracks of the floor.
Right.
The other question I have is, you didn't address anything about the educational problems that we are facing, not only on a national basis, but also here in Indiana and here in Northwest Indiana. One question I wanted to raise was, there seems to be a strong emphasis towards moving towards, you know, charter schools and the voucher program. However, here in Northwest Indiana, especially if you look outside of the private schools, by that I mean church related, like St. Stan's and some of those schools, which are performing well, but if you look at just the charter schools alone, every single charter school in Northwest Indiana from last year to the current year, based on the grading system that the previous superintendent of schools, because I have some issues with one all on the ground, but anyway, based on that same grading system, every single charter school in Northwest Indiana dropped. And most of them are in the D and F range right now. What do you propose that we do to re-emphasize the transformation that needs to take place within the public schools and decrease the push towards charter schools when a lot of evidence-based studies, even on a national basis, say that only 1 out of 6 or only 2 out of 6 are successful at or above the comparable public schools? And especially when you consider also, I'm throwing in no other wrench here, the voucher system, which does not necessarily follow the student. Because if the student goes from a public school to a charter school or to a private school, but then they move somewhere else, that private school and charter school, the way that it's currently done, maintains the use of that voucher throughout the rest of the academic year rather than it reverting back to the public school. Which, if the student is no longer using it because their parents moved somewhere else or they transferred to another school, then by all rights, that should go right back to the public school rather than being continued to be used by the...
But the student is no longer studying.
Right. Right.
A couple of observations. One, there is not any significant help, if you would, that the federal government is going to interject, certainly in the coming year, to change some of the very real problems that you allude to. About 11 cents out of every dollar spent on primary and secondary education across the United States is actually a federal dollar. You're familiar with some of them, the Title I program for educationally disadvantaged, and there's several others. But it's a small portion of the money. Part of the issue is money, but part of it is how we have also now, and the federal government is part of this, a sliced and diced student populations and testing and performance ratings. I would admit to you, I voted for the No Child Left Behind Act in Washington in 2001. I think part of it, as I tell people, was the impulse. As an accountant, I like to count things. But some of this is we have had some school corporations that have not performed well. And in the old days, if you would, certainly from a federal perspective, if I had a really bad school system and they received federal monies and they got worse, they got more money the next year. And it's like, that's not right. I want you to show me you're at least making progress. So you have the issue of testing and evaluation. I would tell you that the time has come and gone also to reevaluate and to change No Child Left Behind. Because we have so sliced and diced these student populations, you allude to one problem as far as just the financing. Students move around. I went to St. Mark's grade school in Gary myself. Almost every child I started with in first grade, we had about 55 kids in our class with one nun. We're the same 55 kids in eighth grade. I have been to schools in communities in Northwest Indiana where the student population in a class in a year is almost 100% different than at the beginning of the year. And you have students who have difficulties, disadvantagements, they have, again, learning disabilities. And to factor them in is missing the point. If you can confirm you've got good teachers, you've got good administrators, you got to stop all this nickel and dime stuff. And I would hope that in the coming Congress, that part of it we would change. But much of this also are state requirements. Charter schools are chartered through state enactment under Ball State University. And additionally, while money is an important issue, as I tell people, nobody beat me up when I went to St. Mark's. Nobody used drugs in my house when I went to St. Mark's. Nobody had an alcohol problem. I had three squares a day. I went for nothing. Nobody let a TV turn on, because we only had three channels back then, until homework was done. And then somebody checked your homework. I can't legislate all of that before. For us as a society, I have a self-interest in having an educated young person so they can get a good job to support me when I'm an old guy. No, I mean, there's some self-interest, but let alone it's the right thing to do.
Right.
So I would suggest, and of course, East Chicago now has an elected school board, to talk to your school board member about your concern, and also state legislators, because one of the things as a citizen of Indiana, I am very upset with, because money does count too, is the disinvestment in education in Indiana. Mm-hmm. It's pronounced at the primary and secondary education, it's pronounced at our university and college level. We are turning our fantastic state universities into private schools. And we're wondering why students end up having $100,000 worth of debt, because we've withdrawn our, but that's a good investment of our money. Mm-hmm. So I would encourage you to contact them as well. Yes, ma'am.
How much does the Congress get paid?
$174,000 a year.
How often do you get a raise?
I have not gotten a raise for 4 years. There is, again, a lot of information on the internet about the raise I got this year.
Oh.
I did not.
Okay.
I did not get a raise in 12, 11, or 10 either. I have not gotten a raise for 4 years. We have also cut our office budget over the last 3 years by 11%. Because I do think it is right. If I'm here telling you we got to put everybody on the table, well, that's us too.
Can I have time for one more question?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Could you I'm sorry, could you clarify, you explained your vote on the DREAM Act, and you stated that there's a difference between those who are here legally and those who are here illegally, even, and it seems like you include those, the youngsters here, that are here with no fault in that second group. Could you clarify, do you just have a fundamental opposition towards the DREAM Act and what it would do, or was there something specifically that you didn't like about it?
No, what I objected to, if you would, as far as my no vote, is understanding the children came, if you would, innocently. Someone brought them here. And last time I looked, there is also the issue of parental responsibility. The United States government did not bring these young people here. Someone in your family or a friend brought them here. And I understand it would be a path that they would have to meet criteria for to gain citizenship. It would be an advantage to them. And all I'm saying is that we have people coming into our office every day who are in the United States legally, who are going through the process. And in a sense, it's very hard to tell them, why are you bothering if, on the other hand, potentially, there will be an advantage at some other point in time.
The government may not have brought them, but we could agree that something here brought them, and that could be employers who are hiring illegals. And is there any legislation that you've supported to either penalize them? And secondly, your vote didn't solve it. They're still here. Mm-hmm. They're still here in the same position, and they're not leaving. They know here as home. So how did your vote change anything? That's my whole, I can't grasp why no would be the answer, especially with the demographic around a lot of your participants, the people you represent, and how we came to be here, and the immigration that happened. So that's how I just can't grasp your vote being no, knowing that there's no resolution, and there's no step towards solving it. It pretty much just passed the buck to, hey, we'll deal with it later, in my opinion. Thank you.
On the employer side, you raise an important point, and I do think in the end, the issue we face as far as those who are in the United States in an undocumented fashion are by and large driven by employer action. My last name is Visclosky, and I just want to make clear, obviously it's a very important issue in the Hispanic community, but we have borders across the nation, ports of entry in the Lake County. And I have one of my colleagues in Chicago whose biggest problem tends to be those who have come from Ireland, depending on where you live in the United States. I don't know what possessed, because I never met them, they were all dead before I was born, my three grandparents who came to the United States, but I'm assuming it is an economic imperative, potentially, I doubt it more, religious or political freedom, but setting that aside, some desperation. I've always thought people who come to the United States have that extra energy. They're kind of risk takers. They have some ambition. They're motivated because they want a better life. Any of those reasons, they want a better life. Having said that, I do think it is that employment. And my concern is employers are taking advantage today of people who are here undocumented. Because they have them at a disadvantage. And therefore, by paying a lower wage, also drive down the wage of everybody else in the United States. Mm-hmm. I am a sponsor. Well, I wasn't last time. We're just starting. We have 2 days, so I'm not on any legislation yet. E-verify. To verify status, to tighten up the rules for employers. And also, I'm encouraged that as far as employer sanctions under the Obama administration, this administration has done a much better job than Bush, because I do think President Bush figured, well, if the employers are making out wealth, and in this case taking advantage of someone's human labor, I'll worry about that other issue later. And President Obama, I do think, knows there's a huge employer component here as well. Gilda, you get the last one.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for being here and, you know, keeping us up to date with everything, plus especially the bridge that I get a chance to cross, and I'll get stopped by the train track. But what I wanted to know was the banking industry. We bailed out the banking industry, but they don't seem to now want to reinvest in the communities for which they got a bill out for. How can we make them go back now and not so much to give more credit, but reinvest in the community that they took all that money from in the first place?
I unfortunately do not hold out much hope to you that during the next year that will change, and I share your sentiment. I've told people in the financial institutions, listen, many of these, they wouldn't exist today without the American taxpayer. And I voted against the bailout because I thought those people should just go to jail. We shouldn't be bailing them out. People committed suicide. They ruined lives. Everybody's 401ks collapsed. Hey, at least pump some money into the economy now, and not in an unreasonable fashion, but in for small business, for job development, as well as mortgages. We've had several programs to try to provide some incentives and encouragement to the banks. We shouldn't have to. We bailed them out. And very little progress has been made. I regret that. What I would be somewhat more hopeful for is that the administration will be aggressive as far as implementing the new financial regulations and also making sure by separating out banking from gambling that it doesn't happen again in imposing the Volcker rule on these institutions and continue to work on that. But with that, I appreciate all of you coming out and these issues will continue.